Welcome back to the caster booth here. I am Zenon the Stoic.
And I am Rivington III.
And together we are still Zennington.
The casting yeti. Yes, we are back for another and second day of the IM World Championship. And these games have been amazing already. Mm. That was awesome. Curse coming in with an absolute sub right off the bat just today. And they were able to take a game against the very favorited TSM.
Yeah, and it looked good. I mean, he did lose top lane, but yeah, it's top lane. As long as you don't...
Well, he lost about 50 CS or so in that instance, but he was able to take that turret first in his lane, giving his team a little bit extra 150 gold around the map. So he did lose his lane, but he was able to help his team out around the map by taking that turret and kind of edging back there.
That is indeed very good. We have next up M5 versus Ehome. And that is the big question mark match of the day. M5. Hyped, maybe deservedly, maybe undeservedly. We'll find out how they held up after Kiev. And Ehome, the big mystery. Nobody knows exactly how good the Chinese players are going to be here today. I am super excited, Rivdo, to see them. Because last time I was in China and I saw these guys, I mean, it was World Elite with the super crazy comps, but still, these guys did things that we didn't quite see. It was like, it was our meta, right? So it was Western meta, but with these little nice little twists that you don't see coming. Like, it was a totally normal lineup, but Galiomid and Fiddle Jungle, so I guess that works as well. That was really a joy to see, and I'm hoping that Ehome are going to do a little bit of something to surprise us today. PDD, their top lane player, did break his wrist.
Yeah, five days ago.
Yes. Ooh. I spoke to him today. I was like, does it actually, like, is it painful? Does it hurt? He was like, yes.
After a while, you think about it. You're consistently clicking. Right. There's tension in your hand all the time. You know, we don't feel it after 8 hours of gameplay and sitting there and eating chips and soda. But when you do break your hand, it kind of hurts.
Yeah, I was like, is it painful? He's like, yes. Is it going to be a problem? No.
Nope.
Okay.
Play right through it.
I guess that man is more hardcore than me. and we see the player spectrum right now. We're looking at M5, of course, to the very right. We have Alex Ish talking to them. This is the, we affectionately call it the gray room. This is the backstage area. Players are waiting to come up on stage, and they are now having the last couple of moments of conversation. Of course, they're not going to give away too much of a secret because the other team is right next to them. Then again, they could speak Russian, the other team could speak Chinese, and nobody would be any the wiser.
That's right. You know, I'm really excited to see this M5 matchup. Still an up and coming, and to say that as is their play style, a little bit unorthodox, but you said keeping with the meta as well, so maybe we'll see a few more combinations. They do like the Mord, Skarner, jungles type of situation in the Ken and bottom AD, but we'll find out what the players have to say as we're going to introduce them on stage with Alin.
Hey, what's up, you guys? I am in the audience at the League of Legends stage. Right before we get to the match, I wanted to introduce to you guys some of the audience members. Are you guys having fun here? Yeah, that's what I like to hear. Now, M5 versus Ehome. Who do you think is going to win and why?
I think M5 will win. I thought their fight in Kiev, there they were very strong. Also against TSM, and I love TSM. And I thought for this game, yes, Moscow 5 will make it.
Alright, well, does Ehome stand a chance against M5? So let's go ahead and welcome M5 and Ehome to the stage. A big round of applause, everybody, for M5 and Ehome.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. I am joined here by Alex from Moscow 5 and Imbat from Ehome. And wow, firstly, I'll go to you, Imbat. I mean, this is your first sort of big European event, I guess. How do you feel it is? I mean, you're on a huge stage here.
Yeah, I feel so exciting now. And I think we are the only Chinese team here. And I also feel sorry about the WE and IG didn't come this competition. So I think we will try our best.
Okay, and then obviously, Alex, you're coming here after winning Kiev. It was a pretty tremendous win, really. I mean, you whitewashed everyone. Are you hoping to come here and do the same sort of thing?
Yeah, sure. We hope that we will make same thing, but teams are stronger now, and they're showing like new heroes, new performance, and we're pretty nervous of the first game because we don't know much about our enemies. So we will try to do our best.
Yeah, and do you know a great deal about Moscow 5? Did you get to watch much of IEM Kiev?
Yeah, I know they are a really strong team, and they got so many champions.
Okay, and how do you feel the events goes for you guys? I mean, did you get to see any of yesterday? I'm not too sure how many of the games yesterday you saw in Group A. Is there anyone you're sort of thinking, we don't want to face them?
Yeah, I think Group A is really a strong group, and so many strong teams there, like CLG. Yeah,
and obviously, Alex, I don't think you got to see any of the games yesterday, but obviously you know who was there. Is there anyone you're sort of thinking, okay, we really don't want to get them? Obviously, you know the position, and I think it was Dignitas first, CLG second, AAA third. You've pretty much played against them or seen them playing all the time. Is there anyone you're sort of thinking, if we get through, we really don't want to face them?
It was pretty expectant that they will be top three, I think. But I thought that AAA will be second or first, to be honest, and CLG third or second. But CLG showed pretty good performance and interesting heroes. I looked at the picks, didn't see the games because we got no time. And I don't really want to meet AAA because our last matches online were not that good. So, and to be honest, we want to go from the first place of the group.
And since you mentioned the online stuff, have you guys had a boot camp? I know before Kiev you were there for a week. Have you done a similar sort of thing?
Yeah, we got boot camp, but this time we got some problems with internet. So it wasn't that perfect that last time. But we got some stuff there. Some good stuff.
Some good stuff. And Imba, is there anything you'd like to say to your fans? Obviously at home, you've traveled a long way, many, many miles, far more than I have, to be here.
Just good luck.
Keep it simple, that's what I like to see. You got anything to say to your fans back home?
Yeah, I want to say hello to my parents, hello to Nyasha, hello to ProDota, and hello to the chat that I'm sitting in.
There you have it, ladies and gentlemen. Let's get back over to our casters. It will be Rivington and Freak, the Zennington combo.
Yes, we are back in the casting booth. Myself, Zenon, and Rivington the third. We are Zennington the casting Yeti, about to bring you this amazing game right here. This is the first time we are going to see a Chinese League of Legends team on European soil. Can they make a name for themselves? And will Moscow 5 be able to play that unorthodox game style of champion picks, but still continuing to play the normal meta?
The big question is, have EHOME properly understood how to counter the counter jungling? Sorry for using counter quite so many times, but it's the only way to say it. Many European teams and some North American teams said, well, yeah, that was completely new to us, that level of aggression, but we have figured out how to counter that now. We've played against teams who picked that up from them, we played against them, and we kind of figured out, you know what, we need to run somebody who can win one-on-ones in the jungle. We need to pull in top lane and mid lane if they invade, let's say, our purple Lizard jungle and so on. Have EHOME figured out how to deal with that? Because Diamond Prox told me at Kiev, I am not a good jungler. He literally said that to me, I'm not a good jungler, I am a good counter jungler. And in order to be a good counter jungler, I need to have a full team supporting me. And the same goes for stopping counter jungle. You can't stop counter jungle by yourself. You are not that hero. You need an entire team to be on your wavelength and say, you know what? I see your jungle's in trouble, I'm immediately going to leave my lane and I am going to help you figure things out.
Yeah, we'll have to see what EHOME can really do here. They are on the top 20 list for 5v5 NA teams on the ladder, so they do play in the NA realm. We'll have to see how they produce there. M5 obviously playing in the European scene and doing their own, not as well online as most teams. They're kind of having trouble online, really bringing the passion to LAN.
Okay, we are almost ready to go on picks and bans here. Let me just impolitely stare at the screen for just a second. yeah, I am not very good with this whole computer thing. Rivington, do you like computers?
Love them. Got to. Have to. League of Legends on the PC. If you haven't checked it out, check it out. LeagueofLegends.com.
There's actually like an analog version where I think you just take dolls and say like pew, 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 pew. It's not quite as much fun, but
you
still.
Can. No, it's not. Yes. Of course. That's not a MOBA.
Nope.
Unless
nope.
You set up your room with three lanes, turrets,
it's a
Nexus.
MOBA because it's not online.
Oh, Daniel. So this game about to go live in just a few minutes. We are getting the casters ready. And yes, we are. So we're going to be jumping into the champ select here. See what the picks and bans are. The picks and bans portion of the game is actually very huge.
Yes.
Each team knows similarly what champions are played by each player on the team. There are roles to be had. The tank, the healer, which is also known as the support. They're going to help the AD bottom, the person that shoots, the arrows, the damage, the swords. What would you think of when you think attack damage?
Swords.
And then you have your mages as well. So all these are going to be picked and banned out with the knowledge of the other team. And we see Rammus and Kennen being the first two bans, two very strong early game and into late game characters as well. Nobody wants to see Rammus in the jungle. And these teams know exactly what they want to ban, not wasting any time. Cassiopeia in mid and Shen as well. Nobody wants to see Shen, top ban of the tournament.
And you just said that this is a super important stage of the game. So normally people take a long time to think about these bans. But these two teams are like, we know what we want to ban against you. Karth is banned as well. So that's two people banned out of mid lane. I'm not sure if they're banning against the mid laner from Ehome or if it's Alex saying, you know what, I can carry for mid lane unless I have Cassiopeia against me or unless I have Karthus against me. So that's a possibility as well. You can ban to free up one of your lanes to carry the game. Rammus banned probably because they don't really like his super strong ganks. And Kennen and Shen, both top laners, the final ban, also Irelia. So three top laners banned there. Maybe that they're thinking that PvD could be in trouble. And oh, there it is.
That's such a surprise.
Trademark. Trademark champion
absolutely,
right there.
Absolutely a trademark pick for Diamond. That's Diamond Prox is his real name, Diamonds. In this one, he will be your jungler for M5. Mm-hmm. And we do see a Ryze pick in middle, a very good pick. Ryze has great range, can usually rune prison outside the attack range of most APs, and can get a great upper hand in middle. We'll have to see what M5 picks for their mid for a...
Alexish.
Yes, thank you.
Yes. That's another thing. They did two things. And there's the Vladimir pick for top lane as well. They did two things at Kiev. One, they popularized counter jungling. And related to that, they also made the tanky mid lane popular again. Because you need that tanky mid lane caster to be able to constantly invade the forest and enable your counter jungler. And Ryze, Mordekaiser, Galio, kind of like the top desired picks for that. So I would expect, I would probably expect Alex Ish to go Mordekaiser, Galio, maybe if they want to run that kind of thing. I think both of them lane decently enough against Bryce. I'm not entirely sure. Actually, I'm not a very good mid lane player. So
Galio would be an Alex pick. His tops are Mord, Ryze, Galio.
Yeah, exactly.
He is going against one of his better players, so he may know how to counter that Ryze with the Galio.
And by the way, guys, we are often very, very wrong here on stream. this happens, and you know what? You can tell us right now. This man is a Rivington III on Twitter with
Indeed.
A3. I am Daniel Z. Klein, at Daniel Z. Klein on Twitter. Use the hashtag IEM. Yesterday we got so very, very close to trending. So today I want to see it trending. Hashtag IEM when you talk about the game. We're going to answer your questions there as well. Call us out at GCETF.
It is a world championship. Let's tweet to the world.
Yes, exactly. TF picked up.
Nice. Another
opposite.
Very high ban within this tournament as well. Xpeke playing a very good TF saw as well.
Well, the 110 TF? Sorry. once it worked, once it didn't. Let me just theory craft that real quick. Very, very squishy pick. So normally it shouldn't really work. But he has that ultimate that has a very large range. And that means if there is an engagement in the jungle, as a result of the counter jungling, they can just have TF port in and turn that 2v2 into a 3v3. And all of a sudden it's like, wow, really? Blitzcrank support? I am kind of all kinds of happy right now. I love seeing Blitzcrank. Don't love seeing Blitzcrank when he tries to be the AD carry and it doesn't work. I'm sorry, double lift. But support Blitzcrank is just brilliant, and we can see Corki running with that. And that is something that in theory, Europe runs as well. I don't remember seeing it at tournaments.
Right.
Maybe I'm wrong. Correct me if I'm wrong. But it's brilliant because you don't need to farm up the Blitzcrank. You just need the utility from those grabs.
This is a really good combination they have going. One thing to point out is Diamonds usually plays junglers that do not use mana.
Yes.
We see him on Lee Sin. We see him on Shyvana. In a way, back in Kiev, that TSM countered that early was they took Shyvana one of those games. No, they took Lee Sin one of those games and instantly gave Reginald blue in middle for the instant the game started. So that was very good. He could play hyper-aggressive against Alex in mid, and he wasn't able to do it. Right now, they're kind of having a dependent blue in middle, and we'll have to see what they can choose for the jungle on Ehome's side. So that could be one way to counter this, but a great pick in mid because TF can just give himself mana. He can slot. He has so many variable utilities to use within that situation. So he may not even need blue early, and he can still give that to Diamond to get around the jungle even faster.
Let me just point one thing out. Blitzcrank could be jungling. Snooper jungles Blitzcrank.
Yes, it would
be strange, but it's possible. But yeah, I'd expect to see a jungle pick for Ehome. And one more thing, Miss Fortune, there's two teams that play Miss Fortune. It's TSM and M5, really. TSM just because I think Chaos just kind of likes her. He just thinks she's a great champion. And on M5, there's a special reason. Miss Fortune's passive strut gives her additional move speed the longer she's out of combat. And that's exactly what M5 want, to be able to go into the enemy jungle quickly. That's also one of the reasons they have popularized the... is it two or three...
This is a fast team, if you think about it.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Two or three Doran's Blades, I think. I think it's two Doran's Blades into Zeal, into Phantom Dancer. After Lantern, of course, but still.
Right.
Very early Phantom Dancer, and that is not just for the move speed and crit, but also for the attack speed, but also for the move speed. And yes, Warwick, talk to me about Warwick.
That's an odd pick. Anybody on this team can get shut down, but the speed of M5 right now, you have Janna with Tailwind as the passive, you have Raise Morale going off by Gangplank, and you also have Darian moving faster off the bat anyways. You have Burnout on Diamonds. This team has speed right now.
Yeah.
So the CC from Ehome is actually very good. We can get a pool under the team. Blitzcrank Silence, Groom Prisons, Corki can stay on the outside with Warwick suppressing somebody, but that suppress, it can't really be broken by too many but Janna right now, so we'll have to see how they utilize that. It's kind of iffy.
I'm a little confused because Genja and Darian weren't swapping. I guess the reason is that the swap didn't quite come through. So we're just going to remake the game real quick as a blind pick so we can get into the game more quickly. I was like, wait, are we going to say mid lane, Gangplank? Are they breaking the meta again? No, it was just the swaps that didn't quite work. But yeah, you're absolutely right. It's going to be a super speedy team.
Super fast. Everybody has a way to make themselves faster. Yeah, besides Janna, she's just fast.
Well, and TF has the mobility of his ultimate as well. It's just like he can be anywhere. And the ultimate from Gangplank is also going to be anywhere. Gangplank's just going to fire a couple of flares into the air and, I guess, use Morse code to give coordinates to his ship. How does he talk to his ship? I don't get that. He's just, I fire my gun to you. Oh, he means to put an ultimate exactly there. How does the ship even know?
That's a flare.
Yeah, but how does it know where to go? Because it can go anywhere, no matter where he is on the map.
Because if it didn't, he would just eat an orange.
All right, then it would be K.
Okay.
Okay. All right, second game is open. Let's spectate that.
Yeah.
I so want to spectate this, Remington. I don't know about you, but I want to see this game.
I think we're going to look on.
Yeah, we are going to look on, observe, spectate.
Yes. So yes, don't forget to hashtag IAM, League of Legends, everything about it. If you're in the Hanover area and you're not here, completely missing out. You're doing it wrong.
And you know what? There's a lot of people here who are doing it right.
No, there's a few.
There's a few. There were so many people already, and I want to just give a round of applause to the audience. Maybe you give a round of applause to yourselves as well. Yeah. Well, some of you, thank you very much. Because listen to that. It's still very early. This is the second game of the day. And there's already so many people. I could not be happier. Let me tell them that we are so ready.
This is going to be an amazing game. I'm actually very happy to be casting this M5 game against Ehome. Two teams that I haven't really seen too much about, know a lot about them and their players, but I love to see this playstyle. And as I said, M5 still a little bit up and coming. They have shown us a lot, and they have made themselves a staple in the community now with that name. But what more can we see from them, and what can Ehome do to counteract that, or what are they going to show us? So this is going to be an amazing game, and I'm really excited.
The naysayers are saying that Kiev was a fluke, that it was catching the Western teams unprepared. I don't believe that. I mean, just the coordination. Still, my favorite line from IEM Kiev is "see hero, kill hero," and that's something that they said to me in an interview. It's like, what makes your playstyle special? And the answer is just like, it's not difficult. The hero, kill hero. And I'm very sorry for my bad Russian accent, but I just had to do it like that. It's like, I was so happy because that is M5's playstyle in a nutshell right there. Super aggressive, but also super coordinated. They'll all jump the same guy. One game you saw an Anivia wall locking off the entire M5 team, and you know what they did? Four flash
over the wall.
Four flashes used over the wall aggressively.
We don't need escapes.
No, we need stab. Just kill
That's
them.
Flash initiation.
Our escape is killing them. That's a pretty good, decent escape. Yeah. After that, you're not in trouble anymore. I cannot wait to see this game. And EHOME, like we said, big, big mystery. I'm going to look at them very, very closely as well. This is going to be one of those games that will tell us how the group is going to go. And I really want EHOME to do well here, but I also want M5 to give us a convincing show, because I want this group to be wide open. People have been saying, yeah, it's going to be TSM, M5, SK, done. I don't want it to be that. I at least want EHOME to be a strong contestant. Who knows? Maybe Cypher, Curse are totally up there. I forgot they won against TSM.
Yeah, TSM, that was huge,
wow.
Especially with a sub, your morale being slightly down because you don't have your player, and he's actually still coming.
Yeah.
So I'm sure he'll be quite pleased that they were still able to do that. And then the camaraderie is going to be that much more. We are going to be jumping into this game, EHOME versus M5, here at the IM World Championship.
And the support blitzcrank starting like any other support in the game right now. 3 wards, 2 potions, and a fairy charm. There's the Janna actually starting with boots. I like that. Immediately the support me says, wait, you're doing it wrong. Don't buy boots. If I buy boots, I get yelled at. But with a highly mobile team like we were talking about, even more mobility, I don't know if she wants to go and wards aggressively early game, but definitely starting with boots. Let's see what Ghost of Pepper is going to do with that. Warwick, probably the easiest jungler in the game, but we've not seen him much. So I'm going to look at Imba a little bit. That's the person that you saw on stage earlier for the interview with Lee. So far, it looks like everybody's setting up extremely passively. They're like, I don't want them in my jungle. And you know what? It's M5. They're probably going to go into your jungle because that is their natural habitat. Boots 3 pots on TF as well, nothing special. I'm just going to go through all the champions. I'm not going to call everything out, but you can see it on your screens in the lower left-hand corner. You can see what skills they chose. Miss Fortune has not leveled up any skill yet. Genja is still waiting what he wants. He's probably going to start with Q for laying her ass. But if there's a level 1 fight, you want to have the slow, the W.
Yep.
On the other team, actually started with a grab. Not quite sure what he tried to grab there because it's on cooldown. everything looks normal for Warwick. The Ryze has not leveled anything yet, but it's going to be the Q for sure. Corki also not leveled anything. And Vladimir going top actually with 4 potions. You can do this. You can stay around and wait for that that gold to tick up so you can buy another potion.
Yep.
And the Wolf's already done here for M5, and they're now moving on to blue.
And some things to mention about these teams. We didn't really look at EHOME too much before they switched on. They have some pretty good sustain. You're coming out with a Vladimir, a possible Wota later, and you have Warwick. So you have 2 people that can deal quite a bit of damage, and if they're focusing TF and MF in these fights, they're going to be able to get some good damage down. Now this MF bottom lane, awesome. Wow. I've been waiting to see this for a while. MF against you. She
top
went
lane.
Top. What top?
She is trolling you.
You think it would be the MF and Janna because of that shield. You can attack Q, which resets your auto attack, and attack again. That's 3 attacks with Janna's shield on you and a huge amount of damage to start your lane. We'll see what Janna does, and they just kind of switched it up here, really.
Yeah, Darien is going... Oh, actually, Darien may die to Golem, so now he's going to be fine. It looks like Darien is going to go a bot lane with Janna, and he needs to already go home and heal. I'm not sure what Janna actually is at the moment. Let's just press that key and... Oh, of course. I'm silly. Where would she be? She's a support, so she's in the enemy jungle, supporting the counter jungle.
Wow, they do see it. It looks like EHOME is going to cover on this. Will they get first blood 3 minutes into the game here? An exhaust onto Imba. Will he be able to get away? There comes Vladimir coming in again, and a nice job by Diamond to pick that first one up onto Imba, and that is something that M5 is known for, the counter jungle early in the game.
and that was great. The red buff did reset, but she just picked it up, even though there were two enemy players around. She knew what to focus on, and with the red buff, there was no way for Warwick to
this
run away.
This is so
there.
Strong. Janna staying with diamonds as they're in the jungle. Janna has the best fight disperse and breakup from that tornado.
Oh, and look at that. Max already harassed down, and they're going to fall.
Pushing him away from the turret.
Tower dive at level 2, because why not? At the same time, we're losing a kill bot lane, but I'm just going to stay with this right now, and he's going to survive.
No, it's actually very good. His bot lane came up, and they were able to take him out. Very nice there to get the 1-for-1 back.
Yeah.
It's very crazy. Gigabyte or TS and Max both low at bottom. Darian doing a very good job of holding that lane. He's actually got a little bit of a burn on him there from Red Buff. Almost takes out TS. And Corki has to be very careful right now. A very aggressive game. 4 minutes in. Already 5K accrued by both teams.
You really want to see those level 2 tower dives, because that's what we're here for. And now it looks like Janna is actually going to stay top lane and leave Darian by himself. It should be fine. I mean, Gangplank can kind of hold a 1v2 lane. He just needs to be very, very passive. I think he could probably figure that out as well. Yep, a little bit of pinging going up at top lane. Not entirely sure what Ehom are trying to do right now. I'm curious why this lane swap. And oh, Corki getting in some trouble again. Has to use Valkyrie here to Valkyrie away, I guess. I'm not quite sure why they're going for that lane swap. Is it really so problematic to lane as Gangplank versus Vladimir? I didn't really think so.
I'm comparing the two in really just the grab, I guess, sitting in the bush. MF has a lot of range with her Q. It goes up to, I believe, 1,000 after that bounce. So she could have a good amount of time just hitting Corki from range, staying out of the range of Phosphorus Bomb or grabs, and really farm behind the minions. But they wanted to play it safe, maybe to shut down Vladimir. They saw the sustain on the team, and they really just want to be able to take that away right from the beginning.
Yeah, and it looks like they are doing a decent enough job zoning him here. So let's have a look at his SCS. He's at 14 versus MF's, well, 18. It's pretty close. And oh, immediately his slow goes down. The Q comes down on him as well. And that was probably not worth it for one CS there, Max. Where's TF going? What is he doing? Alex, you're confusing me.
He's throwing down some wards, I believe.
Oh, yeah, that's possible. And, yep, Diamond just doing his raves there. The Blitzcrank was coming mid lane. I'm not sure if they spotted him. Yeah, they might have. Yep, there's a ward right behind Blitzcrank. So good warding. They're keeping them safe. Have a look what's going up top lane, because that lane is just so strange to me. The bot lane basically against the Vladimir. It looks like they're actually doing a pretty decent job right now. The Max does not look like a happy Hemomancer at the moment.
Yeah, they're doing a really great job against Max up top. They've got a nice ward down, but the lane is just being very pushed. Max has to get in and out every time he farms. Right now, that lane is 26 to 14, so you can already see that Genja is taking a little bit of a lead in CS there. Not so much by level, because Janna is also taking the XP, but more of a roaming Gosu Pepper. Janna roaming.
Yeah, why not? It looks like Genja doesn't need the help in top lane, so why not? Darian doing decently enough in bot lane. He's 27 versus, well, actually 45. Sorry, take that back. He's not doing decently at all. He is falling behind. Now Vladimir is coming bot lane, because they're like, I can't do top lane. So it looks like they're actually following the lane swap. And what's happening here is, if another team is forcing a lane swap on you, they're forcing you to lose time. And that's a nice thing for them. Max finding Pepper there, roaming, and that is, of course, the very reason that Pepper went for the early boots, because he wants to roam from the very beginning.
Yep. And we see Max throwing down a ward there so he can have a little bit of safeness bottom as he farms. His lane is quite pushed. A good rule of thumb, when you're laning, never pass the river alone if you don't have sight. It's quite dangerous. But right now, Max throws down a ward, so he feels quite safe. He does still see Shyvana going back into the jungle, so they're going to call this blue contest. And it looks like Imba and mid will also start to rotate over here, but they're going to catch diamonds. A little bit of damage. Burnout allows him to get away. That W giving him some movement speed. And it looks like they retreat to their jungle. But Gosu Pepper coming in. Such aggression from M5 here, doing what they do best, encountering the jungle. They do have a ward on it. Yep. Warwick could be in range for smite. It looks like they just pulled it out of that. Diamonds will steal the blue, and they're going to just go ahead and clean up those small golem. That small little lizards to clean up that camp, let it respawn. We'll see that coming up again about 13:30, so we'll see again if Diamond goes to pressure that.
It looks like Genja is not doing that well in the classic bot lane, which is now has moved to top lane without his support. He is getting zoned quite a bit. He needs to be careful of that Blitzcrank threat. We saw yesterday Double Lift actually pulling very, very nice moves with his split screen there, surprise clearing the waves with his ultimates, and then grabbing through that, because normally you think, oh, there's minions, I'm safe.
No, you're not. Not if I use my ultimate to clear that wave. You know, the great ward coverage right here by E-Home has, when Janna was going down, that's when they made the switch, and it really helped because then it was a 2v1 situation. Genjin didn't have a support. It was all the way bottom. So they almost did that perfect time. They were able to push her back, and as you said, she was having some trouble. But now kind of getting back into this, trying to farm at the turret. It's a little bit harder. The turret will take out your CS, but there is a method to the madness once you get there, and these guys know that to a T. Here we got Air trying to just sit on the outside here with Blitzcrank, looking for a pull, but there's too many minions there. His claw will not go over minions, and that's what Xenon was just talking about. Once he gets that ultimate, you'll see him clear surprise, and then he'll be able to grab as all those minions fall and try to get somebody off guard. Great damage here by TS up top on Corki, and both of the lanes, or all the lanes, pretty much just milling about, continuing to farm. No real aggression right now.
Darien doing pretty well for himself there in bot lane, actually. He has the wave pushed into the tower, and Miss Fortune going super low. She has an ignite ticking on her. She is going to survive this. There was not a crab. I think it was just straight up aggression from Corki, right?
Yeah, that was just the Valkyrie in, actually, from Corki the turret. So he had enough minions to get there. He wanted to get the ignite on and hopefully a crit shot, but he was not able to do it. I don't think he had any missiles left.
Okay. And still I see the red flashes on Miss Fortune's icon, but she's going to be fine. Alex Ish in mid lane is at 67 versus 65. Creeps, and he started like 10 down against Ryze because he had to go and help in the forest so much. So he is doing a very, very good job against PDD here, the somewhat injured player. Let's have a look at bottom lane. Max just probably just farming it. No, actually, nope, they're swapping back. They're not happy with the swaps like this, so they're bringing Miss Fortune Janna back to bot lane. Alex Ich got caught there a little bit of burst from PDD. Should be fine though. Puts a red card down on him. Oh, doesn't quite hit the wild cards. Very close though. And guess what? Shyvana doing a little bit of dragon killing.
Oh, TF getting the stun card in middle. Goes for the wild cards. Great dodge by PDD. And his ignite will tick to under 100.
Yep, and here we see him. Sorry about that. Genja is back in bot lane. Now there's an ultimate coming from Alex Ish. I don't think he's actually going anywhere. No, probably just spotting for his team. Just also a very valid use of your ultimate.
He is going to be able to use that Destiny. TS ult will let him transport himself a little bit around the map. Not quite global, so we will have to get into that range, but we'll see that coming in later in the gameplay during team fights when somebody's escaping. You'll see TF throw on that Destiny and go ahead and pick himself up a kill if he can choose the right card. Bottom lane being pushed a little bit, and it looks like we are going to see Diamond start to come around. A good vision by Max and team on the bottom lane, so really no gank going to happen there. And it looks like we may have Dragon being contested here in a
Dragon's
few.
Dragon's being picked up. Shyvana just did it.
Just.
Yep, just a moment ago, about maybe a
nice
minute
job.
Ago, she did it with Shyvana. Janna picked up the Dragon there for M5. So that was the first Dragon pickup, and M5 are indeed 2.5k gold ahead. So that is working out nicely for them.
Indeed, it is a great grab on Janna down bottom. The ultimate, the exhaust goes down. She does not have her ultimate as she just used it, but they're not going to be able to get in. They turn to the fight on TS, and it looks like Genja will just stay in this fight, beasting it out. Will he be able to get another shot down? Corki firing the missiles back to retaliate, and it looks like he has just ran out of mana. Both teams make it out alive. As wow, Genja was just face first into that fight the entire time. Warwick coming in with the suppress, and it looks like they could have the grab to pull Genja back out. He dodges. Warwick with another attack, but too slow. Will they get him in the turret? And Imbo will go down as Corki also falls. A double kill for Moscow
Darien
5.
Darien teleporting in, though, has to slow down on Air already. Air is trying to get away. He doesn't have to move. There is the movement speed, but Darien flashing in after him. Not a lot of mana to shield him. The Air is getting super low right now, knocking up Darien, but Darien picking up the kill there.
Wow. Huge aggression by Moscow 5 and great mental play by Genja to know he could just sit in between Corki and Blitzcrank because their cooldowns were down. He was not worried. That was amazing play.
And Diamond immediately going into the enemy forest because why not?
You're going to see that blue coming up in about a minute right now. So maybe you just go for wolves, wait about 30 seconds and grab that blue as well.
And Ryze has rotated to top lane, so they are completely mixing up this game right now. Vladimir is now in mid lane, which is of course something that Vladimir can totally do. Let's have a look at his farm though. It's at 45 and he only has dodge boots. Alex Ish is at 91. Of course, that's not a fair comparison because they've not laned against each other all game. But still, the farm definitely an advantage for M5 here. And guess what? Yep, Diamond picking up that. Actually, the blue buff of the enemy team is going to be given over to M5, and that's not nice. That's Air face checking. They're pulling a bit of a double lift appropriately enough on Blitzcrank, and that's going to be a kill as well. If you go into your own jungle against M5, basically think about it as going into their jungle.
Yeah. Yeah, they make your jungle theirs. It's just one of the things M5 is known for from the first second of the game. Diamonds is like, I feel at home in your jungle.
Yeah, it's nice. It's nice and cozy there. I like your ice cream. I'll take
it. And here we go again. They go from bottom, now top. And where are they? They are in the jungle. Imba finding diamonds right there. Should I say the other way around? That tornado going up, they could have got a little bit more damage, but they didn't want to get too close as they do see Ryze coming around from middle. They don't want to get pinched in too hard. Great play there, and they're really distracting Ehome so much. They're keeping them away from their experience. They are keeping them lane switching. And that lane switch, you think, why don't they just switch back? That time it takes to go from top to bottom or back home to top, you're losing quite a bit of experience. So the amount of times you change will have an effect on the game.
And once again, M5 have that super mobile team, so they lose less time because they have all that mobility already built into their champions and built into the way that they build items. And as we see, it's triple golden. Oh, actually, he's diving in, but Diamond came from behind. Max definitely gonna
not
fall
enough
here.
Time to pool.
Yep. Probably, I'm not even sure if he had pool, but yeah, it didn't matter. They would have picked him up after pool easily enough. And that's going to be top turret for M5 as well. M5 with a dominant performance here.
Yeah, playing very strong. A lot of the aggression coming out of the jungle and just in pure team fights where M5 is capitalizing and coming out on top each time. That Warwick fight bottom was really great in their favor. They lost nobody there, and that gave them a huge lead. Now 6-1, they are up by exactly 6,000 gold.
Corki still out farming Misfortune a little bit, but like I said, that is not a comparison that makes any kind of sense because we didn't have anything like fixed lanes. And Darien, so aggressive against two enemy players. He's like, I don't care. I'll go in against you two. It's fine. I have oranges.
It's okay.
Yep. Exactly what it is. Diamond for a change in his own jungle, and it looks like Misfortune and Janna are now mid lane. Let's just not talk about lanes anymore, Rivington. It doesn't make any sense. These guys do not care about lanes.
They're creating lanes.
Yeah. Yes, exactly.
Diamond likes to lane in the jungle.
Yep, that's pretty much
there's
it.
There's an
the enemy
ulti
jungle.
To clear down the minions in mid. Looks like they will go back. Dragon possibly spawning soon
should
here.
Should be soon. It was around the 10-minute mark, so it should be probably in half a minute or so.
Yeah, it looks like we're going to get Genja, Gosu to back. They're a little low on mana. They want to be able to get into that dragon fight with as much as possible. I believe Alex may be throwing down a ward here. No, he does. Yes, he does have three, but it looks like he's actually going to go up top and save this top turret. Very nice play there. Great map awareness, something you should always be conscious of. What's going on all around the map, because you may be able to assist your teammate even if you have to run all the way across it. So map awareness, a very key factor in League of Legends.
The dragon is indeed coming up soon. I don't think Ehome have a timer. Vladimir does have a teleport while Alex Ish only has his ultimate, so he would need to run until almost mid lane to teleport in decent range. But still, it's not so far, so they can probably go for it. And that is exactly what they seem to be doing right now. Air and TS and Imba coming in strong here. Four members of Team Ehome are already ready for this. Not sure if they have the timer or if they just generally want to push mid lane. Either way, they are showing a lot of presence and M5 is giving them a little bit of room. Darien, is he going home? No, he's actually using his ultimate. Is he using it in mid lane? Yes, he was using the ultimate in mid lane just to scare them off the tower a little bit there and save the tower.
Great job there. Very nice use of that. I thought they were actually going to take that. That would have been their first turret of the game, a little bit of gold. Taking down a turret will give your team global gold, 150 to be exact, 25,000 gold just reached actually by Moscow 5 as they are heavily ahead at this point. A needlessly large rod and almost a Ravidon's onto TF, and Dragon is there totally uncontested. They are going to be able to grab it, and Ehome not in a position to be able to take down Baron. I don't believe they have enough damage yet either. No, the Madrid's only Riggle's not even finished on Imba at this point, so I have to see what they can produce here. Starting to get to mid-game, and it looks like Moscow 5 is getting pretty scary here.
Let me just point this out for everybody watching right now saying, oh, so Ehome is not a contender. That's not what this is. This is even more aggression than M5 usually does. I mean, they've pulled the support counter jungle thing before in Kiev, but just this amount of aggression, I don't know if even TSM would have been prepared for it. This is M5 being on top of their game. It's not Ehome being bad by any means.
No, yeah, you expect to see a jungler in the jungle, so you're going to fight that, but then Janna pops out of the bushes and things go for the worst. So, yeah, not even to be expected. Just like I said, M5 continuously pulling out the unorthodox strats here and making them orthodox.
Very nice. That's exactly what they do. You'll see this in solo queue this week. And I am very, very sorry because the people who will try to tell you will fail. Another blue. No, actually, the Smite Seer coming in here. And Diamond is finally, finally going to pay. No, flashing across the wall. Tries to use his ultimate, gets pulled and knocked up. So finally a kill. For once, Diamond went to the enemy jungle by himself, thought he could be sneaky, and E-Home, very well done, do punish him for it.
And timing that very well, going back for the blue, but E-Home still putting wards on the map. You usually see if the morale starts to fall for a team, you'll forget to do little things like ward, or you maybe won't have enough wards, so you'll place wards just on the objectives when they really need to be on the entry and exit paths of the jungle, and E-Home continues to do that, and that, in the end, can win you a really big fight. If you can catch somebody off guard and then the team tries to help.
Alex Ish in trouble in top lane there. He has to flash away from Max, who used his ultimate, and the Gangplank ultimate is going to keep him safe. It's actually going to get Max rather low, so he has to bail out of that. But that is a flash taken out of Alex Ish, and it looks like at least Max can still 1v1 these guys. He has his Will of the Ancients right now, and there's not a Will on the enemy team quite yet. It's not going to be a Will, no, it's just TF. So Ryze may also build up to Will after a little bit of tankiness.
The double Woda. Yeah, it looks like he's going for that Banshee's Veil first.
Yep.
He's already got the tier, which is going to help him boost up that mana as well.
Yep, and this damage, of course, Ryze, if you didn't know, it scales with total mana. Both his Q and, to a lesser degree, his W scale with his max mana. And his ultimate just gives him tons and tons of max mana, so he just doesn't go out of mana. If you go out of mana on Ryze, you are doing work.
Yeah, right? Machine gun Ryze.
Yeah,
pretty much. Let's see here. Looks like M5 is going to pressure this. A full heal from the team, which now allows Impa to come in with that suppress. They pull Darian out. That's a lot of damage for them there, and they're going to have to not focus on this. Diamond's still taking damage from Baron, so he's not going to be able to help this fight too much. Looks like he does still jump into the fight as he goes down. Ryze with a quick takedown, but it looks like it is going to be a 2-for-1 trade as M5 only losing one and now a second. They are trying to push Imba out of the fight. Great job by TS to continuously do damage. There's the TF ulti trying to find TF. TS, he pulls out the wrong card. And in an all-out fight, M5 using a lot of the bushes and their vision with how many wards they have around Baron. Three. One, two, three. They had all vision everywhere during that fight.
And Darian getting pulled into four members of the enemy team then. He's like, you know what? I'll fight you. That's fine. I'll do that. And that just led to M5 mopping up the team, starting in the river and then slowly rotating up into that area there. And that was a perfect ace there. It was 5-4, was it 2 or 5-3? 5-2, I think.
Yeah.
So that
the
is...
The Diamonds and Darian.
Yeah, that is an exchange I will take any day. The Baron did not get finished. They might have had the damage for it, but why risk it? You know, you just had a 5-4-2. And this is something that we call forcing a Baron.
Yes.
And that's short for forcing a Baron fight. So you don't actually force the Baron buff, you force a fight at Baron by just saying, if you guys don't come here right now and throw down, we're going to take this little earthworm. That's exactly what they're doing right now. They're on Baron again. E-Home don't seem to know or don't seem to think that they want to go for this again. And that's going to be a clean Baron pickup for M5.
Yeah, that was very nice by them. And there goes the ward from PDD. They know that Baron has just been taken. And you can see PDD's like, I kind of don't want to go that way. No, he is going to walk through the jungle. He's going to see Diamond. He's going to go back down. Diamond jumping into that last fight, I was actually kind of confused for a second because he got taken down right away. But when he jumped over, he got close to Ryze and actually took all of Ryze's cooldowns and his ultimate, which allowed the entire team to continue fighting just by taking down Diamonds. All the CDs were down and they really took advantage of that. So,
oh, Darian getting trapped again into five mana. Great grabs here. He does get the rune prison on him. He's still alive, flashes across the street, and Misfortune ultimate is going to pick up one, but there's the teleport in right now. Jumped across the wall. Alex Ish is there as well. Janna is healing them. Everybody's still up from M5. And three man down, soon to be... Actually, yeah, now it's three man down, soon to be four man down from E-Home. It's looking not so good.
Yeah, they were really able to pull that one out. Darian, not the person you want to initiate on. Your cooldowns will not be usable for the next time. Each player has four abilities. Three in the beginning, and once they hit level six, you get your ultimate. So you want to hold those, and you want to use them on the correct people. You pull the tankiest person in the fight and use it on him. You did not get what you were looking for. You only got about 10% of his health. And then the team just wreaks havoc since you can't use any more of your abilities for a few seconds. And that's exactly what M5 continues to do with these irregular pulls.
Yeah, of course they were blind pulling, so that they couldn't exactly pick who they were pulling there. Let's see where Alexish is going. Probably top for farming. Yeah, why not? So they were blind pulling, but when you pull a Gangplank, you also have the option to just disengage and just say, oh, I didn't want that guy. I'm going to throw him back. Like in fishing, you know? Sometimes you didn't want the fish. You throw him back. And oh, there was a flash across the wall here. Trying to chase down Darien. Flash coming out of PDD just caught that on your monitor, Rivington.
Yeah, yeah.
And it looks like Ehom at least got a dragon out of this.
They were hungry for dragon.
very possibly
catching them, taking the blue is what he was looking for. But yeah, that's quite different to flash over the wall just to grab dragon. PDD feeling pretty confident about that. He's going to go ahead and grab blue.
What do you think dragon tastes like? Chicken?
I'm not sure.
Like a giant chicken, right?
I don't know. Yeah. It's probably that stuff in the Matrix that they eat. It just doesn't tasty
they,
wheat.
They
tasty
didn't know
wheat.
What it tastes like. Yeah,
tasty
exactly.
Wheat.
Yeah, they couldn't get it right. Ah, well done. Well done on using a 13-year-old cultural reference. Did I just make you feel old?
Yes.
Yes, very good.
The gray hairs are forming. Here we go as they move down mid lane. It looks like they're going to have some super minion assistance here. Super minion spawn once you take down the inhibitor. And actually, ADs can have some trouble with these guys. It can start doing quite a bit of damage once they spawn if you get them early enough. But nothing going on here. It looks like Max is going to be able to take down this wave quite easily and just kind of let that minion farm up.
Oh, slow going down on Max. Are they going to actually catch him with a second slow? No, he had to use, I think, Ghost. Yeah, he did use Ghost. So that's at least a summoner spell taken out of him. And Alex Ish taking down turrets like a boss. Did that in top lane, of course. He had his ultimate ready to go and join a fight anywhere else on the map. It looks like M5 are now grouping around that bot lane turret. Want to take that down as well.
So don't count out a 5v5 here. We do have Alex coming back into it. He cannot teleport to his team right now. It's a little too far, but he will be able to get into the fight with his team despite the fact that he is just back towards his base. So M5 is still on the aggression right now, and really they have a great control of the map. We just saw Alex top, and that gets really scary for the opposing team when you know that they can start split pushing you, and you have to keep your team with the massive number of their team because of the damage that they do. And you sometimes can't take out a TF. They'll just be able to stun you and run away, and you would be better off with your team.
I just saw that Janna built Zeke's Herald, a new support item that gives everyone a little bit of attack speed and, lifesteal and attack speed. Yeah, it doesn't give any health regen anymore. Yes, so that is great both for Darien and for Miss Fortune, for Genja. Genja, who chose not to finish his PD this time around, I guess the built-in speed from Miss Fortune is enough for him there, the move speed.
Ooh, Max taking a lot of damage top, but he seals the deal with one transfusion, keeping himself alive. Bottom lane still pushing quite hard, and Alex did not use his ultimate to get top, so he still has that in any case. And he looks like he's going to stay top, continue to pressure that turret with a wave coming in. The split push from M5 doing quite a bit of damage here to the base of Ehome. Will they be able to pull out of this? One good fight can really turn things around in League of Legends. We'll have to see if Ehome can pull that around.
In top lane, it still looks like a fight of Vladimir versus TF. And doesn't find anything with a grab here. Diamond actually getting Rune Prison, but that's not who you want to Rune Prison as well. He's jumping in again. The exhaust is down on him. That is going to be fine, though. Actually, he does fall. The ultimate from Genja didn't quite pick up anything, but PDD does fall to normal attacks and Qs from her. And TS not looking good either. Darien picking it up happily enough with a right click. Max now in trouble as well. Alex Ish is dominating. That inhib is going to fall, and I sense a GG coming very, very soon in Rivington. It will not be a lie, because this was a good game from both teams. M5 showing us they are on form. Ehome did look strong, but they just weren't quite ready for this level of aggression. And honestly, who can blame them?
You know, to be denied so many blue buffs, as I said before, Ryze, that blue-dependent middle, TF being able to use blue cards to give himself mana back, as well as having Shyvana in the jungle who doesn't necessarily need blue. So really, that helped to just continue carry on the advantage that they had from that beginning of the laning phase. And then the Moscow 5's intent to always invade the jungle beginning, but that time with Janna, and they just wreaked havoc in the first 4 minutes. It was just in their control.
The ABCs of M5, Rivington, I just thought of that. I'm very proud of myself. The ABCs of M5, always be counter-jungling.
Huh? There's a J in there.
Where? No, it's one word. Counter-jungling. Counter-jungling. One word.
Okay.
I'm German.
I'll give you
Germany.
A dash in the middle. It's one word.
We can stick words together. Germans are very good at that. And we are very, very soon, not quite yet, we're soon going to have a little interview. I'm really looking forward to hearing what Ehome have to say here. whether they were really just surprised, whether it was PDD's problems. But PDD didn't perform too badly, actually. I think he played pretty well. He does look 1-3-3, but honestly, his team had 5 kills, and he was involved in 4 of them. That is not too shabby there. So that was actually well done on his side still. M5 just took this game in a very, very convincing fashion. Actually, there's a kill on Janna as well. Don't quite want that. So it's not a perfect support score for once. Still, doing a great job there. And that early game support counter jungling, yeah, that's... You don't expect 2 people in your jungle at level 1. You don't expect a level 2 tower dive. But it's Russia.
Right after the gank in the jungle, you feel like you'd be safe top, and then Shyvana just comes out from behind your turret at level 2.
I'm a dragon.
I'm a dragon. That's what she said. Going in, they actually didn't get the kill on him. He did survive that, which helped. But still, to be that aggressive and know that, okay, it's level 3, now I'm even more susceptible to be dove. But who does that? These guys.
It's a statement of intent. It shakes your nerves up. It's like, you know what? We're going to be super aggressive. And it's not like in a normal game where it's like, the first 5 minutes, we're going to be fine. Like, 5-minute treaty, 5-minute treaty, right? It's
15 that. Minutes, no rush.
Yeah, exactly. These Russians are like, 2 seconds, then we're going to rush you. Yeah, it's really a joy to watch, and I get to cast another M5 game later in the day. Later in the day, I think the game after the next one is going to be M5 versus TSM. And oh my god, that crutch match from Kiev. Cannot wait for that. But I shouldn't talk about the games that aren't up next. I'm not actually entirely sure what is up next. It could be another TSM match. We'll find out very, very soon. We're actually going to have the Chinese people again. We are going to have SK versus eHome as our next match. And that is, like I said, many people are going to say, eHome, they just weren't good enough. They weren't up for this. But wait until you see them against SK. SK, who, by the way, have boot camped the entire weekend. I just spoke to them, and they seem pumped and ready to take this. But before we move on mentally from this game, let's hear it from the players who just performed for you guys. And let's go over to the stage for an interview.
There we go. So I'm here with the players, and I'll start with you, Alex, because that was a pretty one-sided game, and it was reminiscent of Kiev all over again.
Uh-huh. We used the strategy that we used in Kiev in half-final versus SK. We used it again because we thought that everyone forgot it, so we decided to show this one again.
So is that like heavily down to the Gangplank Shyvana? Because as soon as you saw them pick, we were like, uh-oh.
Yeah, it is Gangplank Shyvana and swap of the lanes with some kind of other stuff that you can see in the game. So we used it again, because, we like it. It's our style.
And Imba, I mean, were you expecting the invade? Did you see these guys at Kiev, how much they invade? Were you kind of expecting them? Because you sort of came as a 2-man defensive team, and then they had 3.
Yeah, I feel so much pressure on the jungle in the early game. The support and Shyvana come to our jungle, I have nothing I can do. Because they're changing the lives, so we feel bad.
And did the lane swap catch you out, with the fact that they used Misfortune at the top to start with?
Yeah, that's a good idea.
It was a good idea. Was that something that you'd pre-planned, the usual bottom lane switch?
We pre-planned it before the game, so it was just as planned.
Yeah, and it's something I've seen in a lot of the scrims, actually. I've seen CLGEU doing it again quite a few times. Is it something you just happened to come up against and you thought, that's a good idea, or is it just something you thought, right, with this particular strategy, we're going to do this?
It's about we can execute it almost perfectly, so we decided that it will be good in the first game of the day.
Yeah, and I don't know how much you were involved, because obviously you were covering mid-fighting at the time, but did you manage to catch a glimpse of what was going on with Genja, how he managed to escape that bottom lane with the Warwick ulti?
I didn't watch much, but I think that he used heal, he was pretty under tower, and then Gangplank ulti slowed everyone else, so they couldn't get in the range of him. And then he just ran away, and Warwick couldn't catch him with his move speed under Janna.
Okay, so I take it with that win, you're feeling pretty confident for the group so far. You've come against the Chinese team, you didn't know anything about them. Next, I believe, I'm not too sure who you've got actually, which one it is, whether it's Cypher or... I think it's Cypher, isn't it?
I think it should be Curse, I'm not sure.
Okay, and what do you think of the other teams in your group at the moment? I mean, obviously TSM, we know you've got a history with. SK Gaming, obviously you came up against in the semi-finals. Is there anyone in particular you're thinking of? I mean, did you saw the Curse game earlier on?
I have seen their game. Their standing is a bit of a weakness, I think, because they don't have that much team play with him. But they did pretty good, and I really liked their play style. They protected Kog that just killed everyone. They used Nuno Kog Molane that we used a lot. So it was really awesome. And I think they are pretty strong. We should, we should think about the game, I think. They use our heroes, so. But I think we will, we got some preparations, so I hope it will be good.
And Imba, you've got SK next, I believe, a team that you would have seen in China. How are you feeling against them to start with? Obviously, you need to reset your minds of what's just happened in that game. It didn't go well. Is it a case of, right, okay, we know these guys, though?
I think we come here to learn some stuff like we never seen before. So I think we have learned a lot of things from i5, and we will try my best.
Okay, well, thank you very much. I guess we're going to pass back to the commentators and be back. Next match will be SK versus EHOM, so don't go anywhere, guys. It's going to be some awesome games. Back to Zenon and Rivington.
Intel Extreme Masters is powered by Then I'm